guys. Welcome back to the Leading Edge Cricket Podcast, episode number 47. I'm Rob, one half of the Leading Edge Cricket Podcast, and today he's got this new nickname. It's going to stick. I am joined by the run-scoring, wicket-taking, ball-catching co-host of the show, Rich.
How's it going? I wondered where he was going with that then. I was getting a little bit worried.
No, that nickname's going to stick. It does mean you need to go and perform every single week now at that level.
Well, no problem, of course.
Of course. Yeah, right. Keep me up the order, skipper. Keep me up the order.
Exactly. Well, it's more I don't really want to bowl much anymore, unless I can do it off two paces and bowl four overs, and that'll do me.
Yeah, I think the bowling at a certain point of life, it comes about timing. As soon as they're seven wickets down, that's when you just start to give the captain the iron. I'm loose, captain. I'm loose. I can take this out.
Yeah, I quite like this time of year as well, especially when we're getting a little bit of rain about. I can kind of just go, you know, watch that rain. It might be raining a little bit. Do you want me to just get through a few overs quick? I'll just bowl off two paces.
You see, these are things young lads need to learn, and it takes years of playing cricket to know when to bowl. You've got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, someone famously said.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's all about now, buddy, isn't it? So, yeah, looking forward to playing again on Saturday. We're playing top of the league, and we're third at the minute. So we've still got an outside chance of getting promoted again after getting promoted last year. So, yeah, looking forward to it.
So the big news, Rich, is Ben Stokes, still ginger, but found not guilty of a fray. And in today's episode, we're going to break down what's gone on there, give our thoughts, and go, hey, Ben Stokes, well, he's back in the Test match squad. And that kind of segues nicely into talking about the third Test match. We did the preview in the last episode, but there's more news. We're a matter of days away from the third Test match starting, so we're going to break down that, as well as go through all the latest county cricket news and everything else going on in the world.
Yeah, absolutely, buddy, absolutely. So without further ado, should we just get to smash the little few bits of news we've got?
Let's do it. Cricket news.
Right, Notts, our beloved county, Nottinghamshire, Robert. We've finally replaced or got an overseas player confirmed. Quinton de Kock was all scheduled to come and play the last five games for Notts, five championship games, but he had to pull out due to Cricket South Africa. So anyway, Notts have finally sorted one out. Craig Braithwaite, or Brathwaite, sorry, the 25-year-old West Indies test opener. So that's an interesting signing. Looking forward to seeing how he gets on and, see if we can score some more runs. I think he's had a little spell in county cricket before, but he did score some runs for West Indies. Was it last year, year before? For West Indies against England. So, big things expected from that fella.
Yeah, he's a good cricketer. He's only 25 years old still, even though it feels like he's been around a hell of a long time. Getting close to 10,000 first-class runs, averaging 41 with 2,100s. But it's his Test match career which is really starting to evolve quite nicely, and he's becoming a real solidified part of this West Indies unit, averaging close to 40 now, 800s, almost 50 Test matches. He's kind of part of the furniture these days.
Yeah, absolutely. It's good to we want West Indies cricket to be established, and we want to see some kind of continuity with their lineup. So players like this, hopefully they'll be able to start building around them as they go forward. Notts, incidentally, they're third in Division 1. It seems a long, long time ago since we were last talking or looking at the Championship. But they're third at the moment, 43 points behind Surrey. Obviously, plenty to play for, five games to go. Hopefully, he'll be able to bang plenty of runs out for the Trent Bridge side to kind of propel Notts up there in their first year back in the top flight.
Yeah, it would be good. It's interesting with this Notts team, because at the start we said the ceiling that they're probably working to is probably mid-table. But the bowling unit has been so strong, especially that early part of the year, and gave them the early wins and threw them up the order. Ross Taylor was a good overseas player in hard conditions. And it's how that batting unit evolves in the last half of the season to really score some runs in some more favourable conditions.
Yeah, that's it. You just hope that it wasn't the conditions that was giving Notts, you know, the extra kind of, you know, ability to bowl teams out. You hope that they will be able to continue that as they pick up the red ball again soon. They're just starting to come into a little bit of form as well, aren't they? They've suddenly realised they had a damn good chance of missing out on the knockout stage of the Vitality Blast. But they're just starting to put some results together, and it's going to be a big playoff, isn't it, on Friday night, so tomorrow night, UK time, between Notts and Yorkshire. Winner goes through in the Northern Group. So, and I think I'm right in saying as well, Rob, that once that we know who's through, we're going to actually jump back into the T20, aren't we, and actually get caught up, review kind of what went on with it, and look forward to the knockout part of the competition.
Yeah, as soon as it gets down into the nitty-gritty, we'll be there. It's really hard. There's so much cricket. There's so much T20 cricket around the world. You can only hover over so much. And now the English T20 competition is obviously very close to the heart of you guys in England and myself. I always, it's on every morning when I wake up in New Zealand, actually, about 6 a.m. every morning. It's like, boom, T20 cricket on. So as soon as we get into the nitty gritty, we will be there.
Absolutely, absolutely. So moving on, kind of with a bit of a T20 theme, Liam Plunkett, Yorkshire, they're not going to offer him a new contract. So he's 33 years old now, is Plunkett. Again, another man that seems like he's been around forever. He's going to move across to Surrey next season. Rest of this campaign, though, he's only going to be featuring in the T20 Blast for Yorkshire. So they better hope, and Liam Plunkett better hope, that they do get a result against Notts on Friday night. Otherwise, it's going to be a quick end to the season for him. he understands that the club wants to go in a different direction. Obviously, there's a budget, he was saying, business decision. We hear that a lot, don't we, in a lot of sports, especially American sports. So he understands the business nature of it. He's not taking it personally. He's looking forward to moving across to Surrey next season. Have I forgot to mention anything about Liam Plunkett, or was that covered it?
No, you've never mentioned, you've not really spoken about him much before, Rich.
Thought that'd be a Regal fan.
Oh, is he? So anyway, that's no idea.
So good luck. I'm a big fan of Liam Plunkett, not just for that reason. I wasn't a big fan of him early on in his England career, but he really did win me over when he came back. He seemed to kind of live at the gym for a while, didn't he? And he's put some timber on, and he came back a big, big unit and a lot quicker bowler. So pleased for him. It's nice that he's going to be carrying on playing as well. Surrey snapping up another good one.
Yep. Solid cricketer, mate. Solid cricketer.
Exactly. So moving across, a couple more bits of transfer news. Lancashire all-rounder Jordan Clark, he's going to be moving to Surrey as well. He's going to be joining Plunkett across at the Oval at the end of the year. He's a 27-year-old all-rounder, 150 wickets so far in his career, 5,000 runs across all formats. So decent cricketer, good championship, county cricketer, isn't he? Disappointing, I'm sure, for Lancashire, but a real kind of positive move again for Surrey. Not sure where all these blokes are going to be playing, though, or how they're going to get into an 11 for Surrey with all the lads that they seem to have.
Yeah, I think Surrey are banking on that half of their team are that young. They're going to be playing in the England setup, and they're just starting to build out that squad.
Absolutely, 100%, really. So Warwickshire, they Mr. Tall, Chris Tall, he will not be particularly happy about this. Josh Poisden, their leg spinner. Good news for Yorkshire, though. He's leaving Warwickshire, and he's going to sign a 3-year deal for Yorkshire, which will start next season. He's going to spend the rest of this season as well on loan at Headingley. So that's an interesting move. Mostly the fact that Adil Rashid is a leg spinner at Yorkshire at the moment. So what that means for him, we shall see. It does seem that Rashid, obviously, I mean, Yorkshire are going to be saying they want to keep Rashid. But it does seem to me as if all the signs are pointing to Rashid not being at Headingley next season.
Yeah, that's quite an interesting move. I'm not quite sure where Adil Rashid will go, just wherever the white ball money takes him. But Poisden's he's 27 years old, but he's such an inexperienced cricketer, so I'll be quite interested to see how he's going to be used. Is he coming in to play multi-format and be across the board, or is he coming in as a championship specialist bowler? You just look at all his stats and you go, he's not played that much cricket for a 27-year-old. So there's obviously something about him that Yorkshire like. It'll be interesting to see where he slots into that unit.
Yeah, it's a real strange one, isn't it? I mean, obviously, when you just look at it from that kind of, satellite view, if you like, that it does sound like they're readying a replacement. But it does seem that the club are trying to keep Rashid. They're negotiating contract going forward with him. But I think it kind of comes down to what Rashid wants as well, doesn't it? If he's suddenly kind of getting a bit of a taste of Test cricket, especially when he gets a win bonus after not doing anything, he didn't even have to carry drinks out, did he, or anything? So, the boy's kind of had an easy little couple of Test matches. So if he does decide that he wants to play that red ball again and he gets himself a contract across all three formats, then I'm sure there's happier days ahead at Yorkshire. But if he doesn't, I'd imagine Yorkshire will try and move on and invest their time in a cricketer that will actually play a lot more cricket for him. Although Rashid, with his background and what a big face he is in the community, etc., especially South Asian community around Yorkshire, it's a big one for Yorkshire. I think if they do lose him, they might just create a little bit of animosity maybe amongst some of the supporter base with how they've dealt with the Rashid situation after he was selected.
Yeah, do you think it is for Yorkshire where they've gone, we've had enough of this, we expected this out of you, you've gone and done this and you've actually, there's too much water under the bridge now and we're actually going to move on. So that's potentially where this move is coming from.
Yeah, it really is a strange one. I mean, you know, everybody's talking about Josh Boyden being a positive character. He's going to come and, you know, work well at the club. You know, Ashley Giles, who's sports director, said it. Martin Moxon's talked about it. So it's just really their behaviour, isn't it? After Rashid was selected for the first test squad, Mark Arthur, the chief exec, came out and just quite a bizarre statement, wasn't it? Criticising the selection, basically, which we can understand why he was doing it and where he was coming from. But for someone within your own county to criticise basically one of your employees, it seemed odd. So no matter what they're trying to say, no matter how they're trying to spin it, this looks to me as if they're getting the ducks in a row in order so they can move on from Rashid.
Yes.
But we shall see. Who knows?
Yeah, Martin Moxon has come out. In fact, I'm just reading it now. He's basically said they are in negotiations with Adil Rashid for 2019. So everything we're saying backs up. It's almost like they're edging the bets and they're going, right, we're moving on, someone new.
Yeah, exactly. So one other bit of news that I thought was quite interesting. Have you had enough of the Currans yet?
I've never had enough of the Currans, actually.
Well, maybe Tom's hairdo occasionally, but Sam, no, we can talk about Sam all day, can't we? Well, it's another Curran. We've got another one, Rob. Ben Curran, brother of Sam and Tom, son of Kevin, obviously, the late Kevin Curran, who played a bit of a county legend, wasn't he? Well, he's a left-handed bat, and he signed a contract with Northamptonshire. That's the county that his dad, Kevin, represented for a number of years. So that's a nice signing. Northampton's obviously struggling across all formats this year. They'll be looking anywhere they can to try and bring some new talent in, a rough diamond somewhere. So apparently he scored heavily in the twos for them. And I think it's the MCC Young Cricketers he has been playing for. So they want to give him an opportunity and hopefully he can do pretty well. So 22 years old, he's a bit older than his brother Sam. I think what would he be, middle brother there? I can't remember how old Tom is now, but good luck to him anyway.
Yeah, good for him. What a cricketing family as well. Kevin Curran was a hell of a cricketer and all three lads now playing professional cricket. Ben's only played two T20 games so far, but... You know, interesting thing, Ben Curran played for Nottinghamshire Seconds as well, just dropping bombs like that at left, right and centre.
Yeah, definitely. So that's the news. It's quite interesting, actually. The transfer market is starting to hot up before the end of the season. So all interesting. I know Notts have got their eyes on a few players as well, haven't they? So every time I see there's a bit of breaking news, someone signing someone, it's like, oh, we've not signed somebody. but that's just from a selfish point of view that I'd like to kind of see a couple of players coming in, let's say, just to strengthen that squad.
Yeah, don't you think county game is better for transfers? Like when I was growing up in the 90s, it felt like no one ever moved unless it was in between the season. Whereas now it's a constant moving market, and I think the game is stronger for it.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it creates kind of competition for places, and it makes sure that people aren't getting too settled down in their average role. You know, if an opening batsman's going for a season average about 20, you know, late 20s or something, not really performing, go and get yourself someone in. If you can strengthen somebody, then go and bring them in. You know, try and, you know, raise the standard across everybody by improving the squad rather than just letting it drop to an ordinary level. So I like it. The game's got more professional, hasn't it? I think, you know, it used to be part-time summer contracts. So people would have jobs, so it's difficult for them to leave their local area if they're whatever job they do the rest of the year. But the more money that's in the game as well, better contracts, better facilities, it's easier now. It's a much more professional sport, isn't it? So I think the chance to move is a lot easier because obviously people are now full-time cricketers.
Yep, they definitely are. And it'll be interesting. Like, we'll never know the answer. But how many good cricketers who could have been professional cricketers or maybe played for England never actually got the chance in the county where they lived and never moved? You know, these days people move left, right and centre. Like Hales was playing down in Cornwall and came to Nottinghamshire. It's the done thing. You travel for your career. Whereas in the past, it was like, I live in Nottinghamshire. There's these two lads that are really good opening and I probably won't get a chance to play in county cricket because there's these two. Whereas they could have played for one of the other 17 counties. So there've been a hell of a lot of players over the years that's probably missed out on a top level career just because there's someone else better in their county.
Yeah, definitely an interesting one. I'm sure that in every kind of cricket club, everyone will know somebody that knows somebody or whatever that kind of is, you know, or he played a few games for the twos, but he didn't quite break into the first team. And then he was a stud club cricketer, kind of, you know, being paid, playing for 10 clubs in 12 years or something, you know, getting a few quid as he plays. But there's always those stories, isn't it? But I suppose kind of a bit of a counter to it might be that, well, if they really wanted to make it, they would have probably moved a little bit away just to try and become a professional. If you love the sport that much, you'll kind of sacrifice one or two things when you're a younger fellow, won't you?
Yeah.
You know, so maybe if they didn't quite have that desire, they might not have really had that success because, you know, you've got to go in all, both feet and everything in at the same time, haven't you, if you want to make a real go of a sporting career.
You definitely do, mate. You definitely do. So moving on then, mate.
Mr. Stokes, by any chance?
Yes, I think it's time to get stuck into the Stokesy train, and let's kind of break down the timeline of events that's gone on in this Ben Stokes saga. Because for me, it feels like it was about 5 years ago that he started getting punchy, but it's actually less than a year ago.
He's only just less than a year ago, though. Where are we? 16th of August today. On the 25th of September last year, this was the ill-fated night after an England game in Bristol. Some of the England lads decided to go and have a bit of a sesh to celebrate. And probably should have had an early night, a bit of room service and stick a chick flick on or something, shouldn't they? I mean, that might have been a better choice, Rob.
Hey, Legally Blonde was created for a reason, and there's a box set. That could have been his Saturday night.
It could have been a hell of a lot better, couldn't it? Anyway, we roll back. September the 25th, Stokes and Alex Hales, they were involved in an incident at about 2:35 a.m. near a nightclub in Bristol. Ryan Alley, he was somebody else in the club. He suffered a fractured eye socket, and another chap called Ryan Hale, he also sought hospital treatment after they were both punched by Ben Stokes. Stokes was arrested, released under investigation. So that's where it all started. Obviously, we then had the sort of people took video clips of it that they saw in the trial recently. That was leaked out. The horrible newspaper, The Sun, they released images of it. And when that happened, ECB quickly, just a couple of days after the incident, basically announced that Stokes and Hales will not be considered for selection for England matches until further notice. October the 11th, Stoke lost his New Balance sponsorship deal.
Yeah.
He didn't have a good time of it around that time. There's some other stuff going on we won't really go into. Then obviously the build up to the Ashes, Stokes was dropped from the England side, wasn't he? So he didn't take any part in that Australia tour. But he did, back in November, though, fly off to New Zealand to play for Canterbury Kings, which he didn't really do particularly well in.
No.
And it was at the same time that the police basically completed their investigation and sent everything off to the CPS, the Crown Prosecution Service. Bizarrely, December the 4th, it was announced Hales would not face criminal charges. And ECB said he's then available for selection. We'll go into Hales' involvement in a little while because it's a little bit of a confusing one for both of us, isn't it? How he's kind of seemed to have just strolled away from this. Stokes then was named in the one-day squad for the Australia part, so he missed the Ashes, but he was going to be involved in some white ball, and then he was home for Christmas. So, New Year, obviously, he played a bit of cricket in New Zealand. January 15th, they were officially charged. Ben Stokes, Ryan Alley and Ryan Hale were all charged with affray. They would then have to plead, well, they all pleaded not guilty to this in court in Bristol Magistrates. Stokes, I believe, doing it all the way from New Zealand. Or at least maybe not that one, but afterwards, I think he had a video link, didn't he, just to kind of get the trial underway. Yeah. So there was a bit of cricket here and there. Stokes has kind of got back in. From all the talk, it was almost sounding like Stokes was a bit of a hero to a few people, helping somebody out at the club. It was all messy, wasn't it? But this trial started on the 6th of August, wasn't it, just after the first test. Alley, Stokes and Hale all went to court. It's quite interesting. Ryan Hale was straight away, his case was dismissed. Basically, out you go. But Ryan Alley and Ben Stokes, their case ran all the way through until the 14th, a couple of days ago, where both Ben Stokes and Ryan Alley were both cleared of the charge of affray. First thing I'll say is we've seen the videos. We've seen, you know, we've heard a lot about it. But obviously, they've been found innocent. Great. Okay, that's all good. The court has found that. They know a hell of a lot more than we do, so we're not going to make any ill-informed sort of comments on that. But how on earth can a video come out and people be fighting outside of a bar, outside a nightclub, somebody get a broken cheekbone and all the rest of it, and there not be any charges? Now, I'm not saying it should have been a fray, but I cannot believe that there's no charges been placed upon anybody from this incident. It just doesn't send a good signal out to society in general.
No, I still kind of rack my head about this, especially when, like, we've spoke on here briefly about the first few days of the trial, and we was going, This does not look good for Ben Stokes. Ben Stokes was acting an aggressor. He was acting aggressive with the bouncers. He was acting aggressive with the gay guys that he ended up defending. It's just very bizarre that over the period of the 7 days while it was in court, that it kind of went from, oh, Ben Stokes, the worst guy in the world, to Ben Stokes, the savior. And I was watching a video before we came on air today. The two guys that he defended who were having homophobic slurs thrown at them by the Ryans, for want of a better term, Ryans, they were saying that Ben Stokes is a hero. And now, I don't know if this is true or not, but it just feels a little bit like ECB PR train has got wrapped all over this somehow. And now it's just kind of rolling out and it's gone, what can we do to save Ben Stokes' image? And it's all PR work going forward. I don't know enough about the court system to go, this is right, this is wrong. I don't know if the decision is right or wrong, but if I look at a video of someone throwing punches, knocking someone out in the middle of the street, I'm like, that's not great. If it's someone being aggressive before they did it, even if it was defending someone, I'm like, that's not great. And then if we look at Alex Hales kicking someone on the floor while they're down, that's not great.
Yeah, I mean, the charge of a fray is quite a serious one, isn't it? So I'm, from my limited knowledge of any of this sort of stuff, if they'd have gone with a lesser charge, there's probably more of a chance they would have actually found a conviction. I mean, they had to have been guilty of something, you know, whether it is an assault or I don't know what the terms are. So forgive me for kind of being ignorant of it. But there must be something out there as a lesser offence that they would have, even if it was just, I don't know, being arseholes and fighting outside the nightclub, whatever that charge would have been. So obviously they were found not guilty. The problem is now, there are CCTV images. There are people's mobile phone images. We've all seen them now, haven't we? They're not going away. You know, once you've seen that, you then see the seriousness. Now, whatever his motivation was, he was still fighting. He's still throwing punches at people. This is not the image that the ECB, the England cricket team, New Balance, any, you know, any sponsors or whatever want to be associated with. This is not the behaviour, as Jonathan Agnew would put, this is not the behaviour people expect from international sportsmen. So there is now going to be, obviously, the due process has been followed, that he can't be charged with anything else. Now the CPS basically said they'll keep reviewing any case, but it seems like criminal charges have been, that's it, we're moved past that point. Both lads have got off. But there is going to be a cricket discipline commission. I think it's an independent commission that's going to be looking into this now. And Alex Hales is also going to be put in front of them. It still seems odd that Hales wasn't taken any further by the police. But that's by the by. And it probably should just be worth adding, actually, that the two Ryans, the alleged homophobic abuse that they threw out, we probably should say that just in case, you never know, do we?
Yeah.
We haven't got enough peanuts to kind of hand out to anyone if anyone tries to sue us.
Exactly. So I'm reading a really good article called thesecretbarrister.com, and it's pretty much a blog, and he's done a really excellent piece on this Ben Stokes case. I mean, I'll tweet it out from our Twitter account. It is a must read. Excellent. And there's one line here that really makes it stand out, and it says, so the verdict means that Ben Stokes is innocent, right? Well, he is presumed innocent, yes. Proven innocent, no. A not guilty verdict means that the jury was not sure of his guilt. It does not mean that he is not guilty. Does that make sense?
To a point, yeah. I mean, there's also somebody shared the route to verdict, which was actually handed out to the jury. So again, we can put this out if anyone had an interest, basically. And it asked three questions. Well, 1, 2A, 2B, and 3, which you then is a flowchart. Basically, this is basically considering, and then if it's a yes or no, and then you follow the next question, and this eventually will lead you to either a not guilty or a guilty verdict.
Yeah.
So you can see the thought process that went through. So it's all very clear. The court haven't been hiding behind anything here. But like I say, we are where we are. It seems bizarre to me that, you know, that he was found not guilty of something, but because it was a fray, maybe that's why it was not guilty, because it was a more serious offence and you're probably looking at, you know, premeditation. I don't know. I don't know the ins and outs. But do you know what I mean? It's just a bit of a bizarre one that they've got away with it. They have. Now the next step is what happens. Hales didn't really miss much cricket, but he did have a little bit of suspension. He's going to be in front of this commission. They'll be asking big questions about basically why are you out at office 2 a.m. with Ben Stokes, both of you. Why are you flashing 300 quid at the bouncer trying to get yourself back in? after you've been kicked out. You know, if you're bound to let them in and someone finds out, they could maybe lose a license for that. I don't know. So it's not just flippant sort of that. And I don't like the arrogance of it as well, trying to get some pound notes out because you've got a few quid. Trying to bribe a bouncer to get back in. It's a bit of a dick move at best, really. They're also going to be, you know, asking, why are you getting into trouble? Why are you getting involved in any situations, knowing who you are? I think they're trying to play the card that they were trying to come to someone's aid, like some shining knights. And maybe that was to the point, but we don't know well enough, do we? And it just, again, it just doesn't sit right with the way they were behaving in general. And it's really not up to Stokes and Hales to decide whether someone's guilty of something and then also punish them. I'm not comfortable with that, because that's when if a mistake is happening, someone beats the hell out of somebody, as a lot of society like to think is the right way of dishing out justice.
Yep.
If you get that wrong, then there's an innocent person been knackered, haven't they? So I don't really like that, and I'm not a big fan of saying, well, good on him, glad he punched him, he was sticking up for somebody else. It's a messy situation. Nothing good ever comes out of being at half two in the morning if you're a professional sportsman.
No.
And it'll be interesting to see what the findings of this commission comes. And just, sorry, circling all the way around to what I was going to say, he's already had a ban. He's missed the Ashes. He's missed 5 test matches. Has he been banned enough?
Yep.
Or do you think that the disciplinary commission will come down on them and mete out further punishment?
Is the verdict right? And this is what the secret barrister's got to say. And I think this is what everyone should take away from it. Because one, we're not involved. Two, we're going off what we read in the media. We're not across the actual court case itself. We don't hear everything. So he's basically put, I don't know. I didn't hear all the evidence, and nor will you. And unless you're a juror, reporter, or member of the public who attended every day of the trial and absorbed all the evidence, you don't know either. You have an incomplete picture and shouldn't be commenting. So I think that kind of takes our line on it. It's, there are question marks around it that people don't understand, that we don't understand. I've been reading through Twitter, and there's a hell of a lot of hate going out there for Ben Stokes. I think Ben Stokes has just got to try and move on with his life. It's probably been a very, very stressful year for him. Emotionally, mentally, physically, it'll all take its toll on him. And somehow, some way, we just need to package it away and go, what's done is done. Ben Stokes, do not be outside a nightclub at 2:30 in the morning with Alex Hales drinking, trying to get into a bar. I didn't like that piece that they were doing, exactly as you said. And it's what goes on for Ben Stokes and Alex Hales next. And hopefully, the guys who got punched can move on with their life and live a happy life and learn and be better for it. The guys who are having the homophobic slurs apparently thrown at them, they can move on and they can go and live their life. And Ben Stokes and Alex Hales can go on and they can play cricket for a few more years and just enjoy being an international cricketer. And hopefully they've got a great deal more understanding and gratefulness for the position that they're in.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it's just that whole situation, isn't it? I mean, you know, a lot of us, you know, we'll go through life and maybe at some point in our teens or in our 20s, we'll get into a situation which is a little bit of a wake-up call. Usually it's not serious. It's not played out in the public eye. So it's not too bad for us, is it? But you know, when you are in the middle of a one-day series, you're a vice-captain of your national team, do you really need to be kind of giving it the big one in a nightclub in Bristol? I'm not sure you do. I think that, you know, he's paid a dear price, really, hasn't he? He's missed a lot of cricket. He's had his reputation tarnished, as has Hales as well, really. Hales was at that point on the kind of move towards the conversation of get him in the England test side for the Australia, you know, the Ashes, wasn't he? That kind of quietened down sharpish after this incident as well. So it, you know, they have kind of paid a price, haven't they, I suppose. With regard to to any further bans, I think it's time that they did move on. I think it's time, you know, they did lose some cricket, didn't they? I hope they don't come down too harshly on them. I think it is time just to move forward with it. But I'd like to see them doing something positive with Hales and Stokes. Maybe get them out into some community sort of enterprises. Maybe get them into something where they can actually pass the message on to young cricketers. Be a kind of beacon of, look, you know, this is the mistakes you can make. I was lucky to get away with it. You know, a bit like Chris Lewis, the old England all-rounder. You know, he got banged up, didn't he, in the end? In prison, and you know, he goes, I've been reading something a year or so ago, he goes around counties now and tries to pass on his experiences so as to make sure other people don't make the same mistakes. And I think that's what we need to do with Stokes, and maybe to a lesser degree Hales. But punishment wise I think we need to move on from it a little bit now. Also, I think we've just about covered off most of the Stokes conversation, Rob, but I think it's probably just worth mentioning just a few of our lovely kind people that do kind of chat to us occasionally on Twitter, etc. Traff Cricket, do like this fella. Great photography. Give him a follow if you kind of get a chance to on Twitter. He's put very, very polarized opinions to me. He was guilty of putting himself into a situation he should not have been and thus exposed himself to the consequences that followed. In the round, he has paid the price. Move on. I think that's kind of similar to what the kind of view we're taking, isn't it? Isn't it, Rob? Rob Matchett, a good pal of ours, we used to play cricket with back in England, should have thrown the key away. I mean, that's more a personal opinion of Ben Stokes rather than what happened.
Yes, I'd say so.
Also at kill underscore schmoods, in response to my tweet of what, so Ben Stokes found not guilty, let's hope this is the time he now grows up a bit. As for England, tough decision, could be selected, lots of things to consider. In response to that, kill schmoods said, growing up in regards to his behaviour at a nightclub, yeah. If he sees a guy attack another with a bottle again, I hope he behaves in exactly the same way, or a knife, or any weapon for that matter. So I can see where Kilschmoods is coming from with that one as well. It's a difficult one, isn't it? Unless you're out in the, you know, in that sort of area and in that situation, it's such a tough sort of situation to judge, isn't it? In the, you know, when we're sat here just chatting away, it's a much easier scenario. But when you're there, it's a different thing altogether, isn't it? So some kind of interesting points made there, Rob.
Yeah, very, very interesting points. We ran a poll as well, which a lot of you voted in, and there's kind of four choices here. One's a bit throwaway comment. So basically, should he have been found guilty in your opinion? 24% of people that voted said he should have been felt guilty. The right decision was not guilty. 18% of you agree with that decision. 45% of you just say, move on, forget it. Whatever, it's been, let's just move on. And then 13% of you say, Wokes over Stokes. So 45% of you just want to move on and just forget the whole situation happened and let's just move forward and try and, I'm going to drop the R-bomb, let's reintegrate him into this England lineup.
Yes, KP. So, there's just too much of that for me. I can't keep up with this reintegration nonsense.
Oh, no. It's a silly word. I used it at work the other day, and it had no meaning. I've just got like this R-bomb that I can't stop dropping. I'm reintegrating myself back to the gym this week. You know, who says that?
You just went back. That's
exactly.
All you did. It's not reintegration.
Exactly. I just stopped being lazy and went back to the gym. I didn't reintegrate back to the dumbbell. No.
I love it, mate. Love it. So it's such a strange situation, isn't it, with this one? It's like we say, I think we're done, aren't we? I think we're done. I think it's time to move on now. Yes, he's got himself in a stupid situation. The disciplinary, that's where it's going to be interesting. Will they go and do anything for him? You know, will him and Hales be in trouble? Stokes has missed out on the Ashes. He missed out five test matches. So technically, he's had a five test match ban, hasn't he? It's also affected him other ways, I'm sure. He's probably faced enough punishment now. As for Hales, I don't know. I don't know where we go with him. You know, it'll be interesting. It'll be interesting to see what they decide on both of those boys, really, isn't it, Rob?
Yeah. Yeah. I just hope it's 6 months down the line and there's nothing else that comes out about this and it can just be all forgotten. Ben Stokes starts playing back for England again. Alex Hales continues to be a white ball mercenary but plays well for England in T20 and maybe a bit of one-day cricket. And we just enjoy the remainder of what has been a fascinating series so far, which feels like an excellent segue to start talking about the third test match. Now, the preview's been done, but Ben Stokes added to the squad, Rich. What does that mean for this England lineup?
Yeah, so obviously with Stokes coming back in the squad, it's interesting. Trevor Bayliss has kind of come out. He's kind of put a few things on you know, out there into the public domain. So he's talking about that. Bringing Stokes back, it was kind of good for his well-being. You know, he was going to be assessed mentally and physically over a couple of days of training before a decision is made whether or not he returns to the starting 11. So obviously in the first test, he played really well, didn't he? Bayliss has said, look, it was a collective decision. Myself, management, captain, the board, Ed Smith, Andy Flowers, who's the standing at the minute for Strauss, everyone had their say. It was basically thought that for his own well-being, it was good to get Ben back around cricket. Nothing automatic about selection, so you're going to see how he goes. And it's kind of, that's where they are, you know. I can see his point of view. You know, Stokes is a valued member of that team. He's a friend to everybody, isn't he? He's not just a teammate, I'm sure. They're quite a tight-knit bunch. So they wanted him in and around the squad. Obviously, they made that decision. It's probably best for him at the moment, and I'm sure Stokes would have agreed. If he wanted to, he would have had a week off, and I'm sure the ECB would have been fine with that. So he's back in and around the squad. As for the question of whether he plays or not, it's a damn good one, isn't it? After the second test, I don't know who you drop. You can't drop Wokes.
No.
Just can't drop Wokes. Sam Curran, how can you drop Sam Curran? After the way he's played so far, a fledgling test career, you can't drop him out there. Josh Butler could be a potential player that you could drop. You know, he's a batsman, he's not a wicketkeeper, is he? So you could bring Stokes in for Butler. But Butler has just been named vice-captain of the test side. So I can't see how they would decide that he would drop out. Ollie Pope, well, he's just made his debut, scored 28, took a catch, got a run out. You know, he's learning test cricket. You've just brought him in the team to try and solve a middle order problem. And then you can't kick him out of the team. So I don't really know where we go with that. For me, at Trent Bridge, my response would be that Stokes sits out.
Yeah. I think I'm going to agree with you there. And I think it's just because England's made a rod for their own back. So Adil Rashid, England are basically saying we need to pick a spinner against India, given that we've just played in the most overcast of overcast seam bowling conditions of all time, and they still went with the spinner. So a spinner will play at Trent Bridge, even though Trent Bridge has the highest bowling averages in test cricket in the country for a spinner. I still think they'll pick Rashid. Sam Curran, man of the match, first test. Chris Wokes, man of the match, second test. Both of them performing above expectations. Why change a winning unit? And Josh Butler could be the one that could get dropped, but then you go and make him vice-captain, even though he's not played test cricket since 2016 when he failed at it first time round. So it's a very, very difficult situation. I think when we spoke on the last podcast, I said, I think Stokes doesn't play. It's great that he's in the squad. He might carry drinks for the day and just be around the squad. It's probably the best thing for his mental health to try and move on. But I think they almost give Curran, Wokes, Butler enough rope to hypothetically hang themselves as a test cricketer and get Stokes back into the mixer. They're going to go, right, you guys go out and play, you've earned it. And then whoever kind of falls off the bandwagon first is where Stokes is going to come in.
Yeah. I think that's it, isn't it? I think just for this test as well, it's just kind of sit him out. There's another kind of person that or option. Obviously, Rashid is an option, isn't it? I mean, if you did drop him, though, but then you are saying, okay, Joe Root is the guy that's going to bowl a few overs of spin if required. It is a tough one to kind of decide who goes where, isn't it? And it's like Broad as well. That was the other one I was going to say. Broad is somebody that said, what about resting Broad? We spoke about it last time. There's no way in the world I want Broad or Anderson rested until we've won this series. And if we win at Trent Bridge, that's when I'll think about resting Broad and Anderson. Yep. And maybe each of them rest for one of those remaining test matches. That would be my way of going forward and give another bowler an opportunity. I'm just trying to work the team out a little bit here. And, you know, I suppose, I don't know, it's such a difficult one, isn't it? I was thinking, is there a way of working Ali into the team and then getting Stokes in? But that doesn't really help anybody anyway, does it? So I think just go as you are, unchanged for the next test, and take it from there. If Rashid, if Stokes is deemed that he's mentally and physically ready to play test cricket, and they look at it and go, there's no chance on this planet that we're going to need a real frontline spinner, you know, Rashid's going to basically have the same day as he did at Lord's, then why bother? Then you may as well put Stokes in. But I don't see the benefit of it. I think leave him out, get him out of the spotlight. He's been in and around the team, been with his mates. Sit him out and then come again for the next test. And I'm sure he'll work his way back in the lineup then.
Yeah, 100% agree with that. Don't change a winning unit. We've just absolutely thrashed India by an innings at Lord's, which no one expected. England are on fire. Seam bowlers are bowling well. Young lads are playing well. Let's not rock the boat. Let's just go in, win this test match, get out of Trent Bridge, and then look at maybe bringing Stokes in for one or two of the last test matches of the summer and maybe resting abroad in Anderson and getting him in that way. But I agree, Rich. Now, we spent time at length talking about this Indian team and how the hell India fixed themselves for this third test match. Mm-hmm. And we came up with multiple ideas in terms of Pujara at the top of the order, bringing in Rishabh Pant, all these different things. Have you heard any rumours on the grapevine about what India are actually going to do for the third test?
Well, there's somebody kind of putting two and two together at the minute. Nothing's come out from the Indian camp yet, but based on a training session, apparently, this is according to Nagaraj Golapudi, who was at Trent Bridge, who's writing for ESPN. He's basically said that Rishabh Pant might be in line for his test debut based on a training session India had at Trent Bridge 2 days before the third test. So Dinesh Kartik, obviously he was feeding balls to Pant during the wicketkeeper drills. So this could be that this is what they do anyway. It's two wicketkeepers in the squad. It's a bit like a quarterback throwing to each other, isn't it? So it's going to be interesting, isn't it? I think there is definitely a movement towards Pant playing. There must be conversations ongoing with how India can strengthen the batting lineup. It's probably just worth me at this point just mentioning a pal of ours who listens. Jits Jani, he kind of gave me a bit of grief the other night when we was at Forest, and he said, that last podcast, that was rubbish, that last podcast. And I think he's talking about the one when we crucified India, where we basically said how shockingly bad this Indian side was and the performance was in the second test. So that's the reason he thought it was a dreadful podcast. So I just want to say hello here on here, Jits. And I did say to him, I'm sure I'm going to see him in an England shirt soon if England keep playing well. but maybe Rishabh Pant is one of the moves that India can make to just solidify that lineup. There is pressure on Rahane, but you know, Ravi Shastri and others have come out and tried to defend people like Rahane. But Pant, he's an obvious one that they could make a change with. Straight swap to take the wicketkeeper gloves off Kartik. I'd be really excited by that decision if I was an Indian cricket fan. And also, personally, I would be excited by that decision if he does play. I'd love to see him take that step up into Test cricket.
Yep. See, I am not going to drop an apology for blasting this Indian team because they're number one team in the world and they are playing absolutely shocking. It's not to say that India are a bad team. They are playing shocking and some of the best players are really struggling to adapt to English conditions. And a lot of the guys who listen to the podcast will probably go, Bobby, stop blasting this Indian team, just like your friend. Whereas actually deep down when they look at it, and if we went, this is an England team that lost by an innings and 180 runs, we would be going at them great guns. Get Jennings out of the team. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. So the flak that this Indian team are getting, in my eyes, is more than justified. They need to step up the game. They've got to be better. They've got to be better. Otherwise, they run the risk of being whitewashed 5-0 in England.
Yeah, exactly. Just going on with Ravi Shastri as well, just talking, he's defending his players. He's talking about questions persisting over Rahane. But Ravi Shastri's given him his full support. He said he's one of our pillars. He will remain one of our pillars. Conditions have been tough, as you've seen right through the series, but that's where character comes into play and mental discipline comes into play. The resolve to know we're off some pitch, to leave a lot of balls, to be prepared to look ugly and dirty and show some grit is needed. Absolutely bang on, isn't it? And that's what is needed. So, you know, there might not be as big a change as we think. It might just be, this is your chance, fellas. Some of you very, very experienced batsmen. It is now time to go out and show the world why you are such a good batsman, why you're averaging late 40s, 50 in Test cricket. And do it. And if they don't do it in the third test, then I'm sure there will be big, big changes. We spoke about the likes of Karun Nair, didn't we, etc.
Yeah.
So it's going to be interesting. Maybe Pant is a change. One change, I'm sure, Kuldeep Shastri has come out and said that was a mistake playing Kuldeep Yadav in the second test. In hindsight, it was an error. Seeing the conditions, we could have gone with an extra seamer. That might have helped. Honest words from Shastri as well. But it's just the way it is, isn't it? You can't make every correct decision. You know, you're trying to anticipate 5 days of cricket and the conditions that will come. Nobody can see in the future, can they? So I'm sure they picked Yadav with the right motivations. But we said, didn't we, really, we would have preferred to have seen Jadeja if you were going with a second spinner. But if not, really, it was a time of getting another seamer in there. So I think, you know, who knows? If there's any changes, maybe it's one. We were talking maybe you could get Pujara up to open the innings. Just make that first wicket a little bit more difficult for England to take. But we shall see. Anything from you, Rob, on the Indian side or the makeup of the England team?
No, I think the England team's the best option they can do is not change it. It's playing very, very well together. It's giving time to blood. It's Keaton Jennings' last opportunity in my eyes. If he fails the first three Test matches here on top of failing against Pakistan, that's four Test matches, come back, not score a 50. That's Jennings done. We've got two Test matches left of the summer. Let's give a new opener, one of the young lads, a go. Let's give Ollie Pope a go, especially if the series is won. It gives a young lad an opportunity to come into a winning team and just play a couple of games of Test cricket with the lowest form of pressure that you could ever play Test cricket in, which is increasingly high, but it's a great opportunity to do it. India, I hope they make changes. I'm not sold on Rahane as a Test cricketer. Is he a pillar? I feel like he's crumbling if he's a pillar. I feel like the Roman Empire is coming down a little bit. I do think Nair should be involved. I think Jadeja should be involved. I don't think Pant should be involved. It's the Indian bowling lineup is bowling well. The batting is the part that's failing. They need to concentrate on that batting and they need to sort out that top six.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Just coming back to Ravi Shastri just for a moment, Rob. Sorry, just change the subject. But at Rotten Jay, Jason Rotten, one of the podcast kind of followers, he's just mentioned as well about Ravi Shastri's take on Ben Stokes, and this is quite a good one as well. He's basically said, look, what's the problem? He's cleared in the courts, wasn't he? Let's just move on.
Yeah.
So he's basically saying, look, if he's cleared, then why shouldn't he play? So that's an interesting perspective from Shastri as well. It's quite nice that he's got out there and said it. I think as well. Rivlud, I don't know if you've seen one of our friends of the podcast, at Rivlud. He's been in touch as well, just talking about India. He's a real passionate Indian cricket fan, this fella. India accept failure, not adapting to the way things are being played. England blood, in the next generation, but Indian commentators, etc., BCCI and Ravi Shastri are basically for the here and now. And he's saying that the youngsters really could do a far better job than the rubbish that some of the seniors have served up so far. Went on to just make a couple of comments about, basically England did kind of have the best conditions and there was some drops, etc. So, those things do even out, don't they, over series. So we'll see if conditions and drops, etc. Because England do drop their fair share of catches. But good points again from Riv there. And I think we said it before the second test, we need a really competitive test match. This series was all set. We were getting so excited about this series being a real back and forth, basically a cigarette paper between the two sides. 3-2 is my prediction. Yours was a 2-1, Rob, wasn't it, with two games being lost to rain. We need to see the Indian side that everyone's been telling us about, and then we'll certainly give them a hell of a lot more credit because we want to, because we know how good some of these cricketers are. But as we said in the preview, I don't think we can look past another England win, regardless of the makeup of the two sides.
Yep, I completely agree. I think we're going 3-0 England. I think Jennings, I said, would be the top run scorer of the series. That may be a stretch. That may be a bit of a stretch. It could well be Jennings' last test match for England. That's how he should feel going into this test match. He's the one that's feeling the pressure out the top order. Everyone else, for an average top order in terms of production, is pretty solid, this England team. So quite excited. India, they need to turn up. Their batting has to turn up. Their top six needs to perform. And it takes someone other than Kohli. You can't back Kohli every single time to score runs, even though he's averaging over 50 this winter in South Africa and England. That's great he's doing that, but no one else is averaging over 17. That is why this India team is fundamentally failing. And those guys, one of them has surely got to... You just strap on the grapefruits and go, today's going to be my day. I am not going to throw my wicket away. I'm not going hard at the ball. I'm going to bat time, and I'm going to go and bat bloody well and give this Indian team the best chance of winning. That's how I feel they need to go.
Yeah, definitely. And I do wonder as well, we've kind of looked at the batting lineup, as in the top six or so. That's where we've been kind of focusing. But I wonder if another way of India just strengthening their batting lineup is, instead of maybe making too many drastic changes in the top six or so, maybe Pant comes in for Dinesh Kartik, but that's one thing. Maybe what they'll do is look to strengthen that lower middle order and the tail. Maybe Jadeja can come in for Pandya. Is Jadeja maybe the counter-attacking style of batting? He did well in England last time, if memory serves. And then maybe for the, you've got your spin option there, with Ashwin, etc. You don't need your dab. Then maybe you can potentially bring maybe another seamer in if Bumrah's fit for Kuldeep Yadav. Or bring Umesh Yadav back in if Bumrah's not fit. But it's been a big miss for India. They have lost. They have been missing two of their big bowlers, haven't they? Bumrah and Kumar. So
yeah.
We shall see, as we always say, Rob. We shall see. But yeah, roll on Saturday. Roll on a big game for the Newark R&M boys, and roll on an even bigger game for India and England, of course. And we'll look forward to breaking it all down as and when we get through it. Hopefully the test lasts a bit longer this time.
Yep, can't bloody wait. 10 o'clock New Zealand time, Saturday night, the test match starts. It still feels wrong watching a test match at 10 o'clock at night when England are playing, but I can't bloody wait, my friend. Anything else today from yourself?
No, not really. I mean, just quickly make one last mention about Stokes, really. He's just, coming from, reading an article from Jonathan Agnew, who's always a sage kind of mind, isn't he? Is that the inquiry, that whole point about why so many players were out midway through a series, hopefully by now we've already righted that, and the England authorities and the England set up kind of give them better instruction and the players have got better kind of decision making. But hopefully that's been sorted. And also just this review that's going to be coming through, he goes on to say he really hopes it's going to be a balanced sort of thing. The issues obviously with the incident, but also let's not go too hard on the boys. Let's be constructive. Maybe put them to good use, put them into certain settings. you know, help them get in the community, help them teach players, you know, teach other players, you know, from their mistakes. So we can be positive from it rather than just, you know, banning or disciplining these players. Hopefully some positive will come from it all.
Yeah. It's a nice way to finish, Aris. Nice way to finish. Nice touch as always. Thank you so much for your time, my friend. You guys have been legends. Till next time.